Today we are discussing hematological interpretations of canine blood samples. As everybody knows, the hematology is most important factor for the interpretation of the various disease conditions in canines. And usually, we need the hematological analysis every time and most of the times for the every case. So we are discussing as far as possible many things, and the remaining things, if anything remain, you can contact me later on, or we try to discuss in the at the last time of this our webinar. So as he has introduced me, so we are working as a Omega laboratory since last 14 years in the field. More than 2.5 lakhs blood samples has been carried out. Then the 13,500 postmortems, diagnostic postmortems, and we have collaboration with the various multinationals, national companies, and we are conducting various efficacy trials and clinical trials for the different veterinary medicinal products. Now today, actually we start with this hematological analysis. So hematology includes different panels or indices, we can call indices, erythrocytic indices, leukocytic indices, and the thrombocytic indices. So erythrocytic indices are dealing with the RBC and related parameters. Leukocytes are related to the leukocytes and related parameters, and thrombocytic index indicates the thrombocytes and its different parameters. Now starting with the erythrocytic panel or erythrocytic indices, it includes estimation of hemoglobin, estimation of RBC, estimation of packed cell volume, then MCV, MCH, MCHC, then ESR, then red cell distribution width, red RDW, it is also called as RDW, then estimation of reticulocyte count, immature RBC, and nucleated RBC. So these things are come under the erythrocytic panel. Then leukocytic panel, that includes the total leukocytic count, differential leukocytic count. Then in the differential, you will have the neutrophils, maybe mature, immature, then eosinophils count, basophil, then lymphocyte and monocyte. So this is about the leukocytic panel. Then thrombocytic panel. Thrombocytic panel includes the total thrombocytic count, mean platelet volume, then mean platelet component concentration, then the evaluation of morphology and the presence of some inclusions or any other things or pathological alterations that can be observed in platelets. So that is, these are the three main panels which are we are dealing with today. Now, as you know, there are different methods of the analysis of blood sample. So generally up till now or many years back, some inventions has been carried out. Many machines are come, or automatic analyzers has been installed in so many laboratories. But there are two major methods. The first is a manual method, in that includes the hemoglobinometer, then Nuvar chambers or hemocytometer, hematocrit tubes, packed cell volume, ESR. And the another method is a use of automatic analyzer, that may be the 3-part or 5-part machine. Now these both of the methods are having its own advantages as well as the disadvantages. So we'll take some shot of that. See, error in both type of evaluation or the both type of methods will have some error. So machine, improper mixing. So what happens, sometimes it may happen, that will be called as a human error. If the sample is not mixed properly, then machine will sieve that type of sample and the faulty results may come out. Then counting error, sometimes the whenever there is any pathological conditions related to the cells, there may be some alteration in the panel of the cells. If the size of cells will be increased, the size of platelets, say for example, platelet size increase or RBC size are increased, then if the RBCs are large number of nucleated RBCs are there, in such cases there are some little bit chances of change in the total count of the machines. Then relative increase in one panel, that will be count in another panel. If the nucleated RBCs are there, they may be unfortunately may be counted into the cells or the leukocytes. Then seeping error, so generally the machine seeps some a small quantity of blood. So if the sample is not mixed properly, say for example, if the ESR of the particular case is higher, if the higher ESR is there, so RBCs are generally get settled down very fastly. So in such cases, if you are giving sample to the that machine, so you may get sometime a faulty result in that case. Then what are the different disadvantages of the manual method? So here again, the with the manual method, we cannot do the large number of samples. The very less number of samples can be estimated. Then man-made errors are more common, may be common. The mixing, the counting, some visual effects. So all these things may be happen with the manual method also. Then personal variations and identification of cell is another factor. So these are the some disadvantages of the manual methods too. Now, after if the both the things are there, so finally what we have to do, we have to go for CBC, either maybe by the manual method or maybe by the machine method. So ultimately we have to interpret the result, and after interpretation of the result, we must go for the proper treatment of that particular dogs. Then we have to find out its prognostic value. Then the you should go for the some preventive measures. So some preventive measures can be prepared according to the our samples and the hematological interpretations, whatever we are getting, either by manual method or by the machine method. Now we'll start with the erythrocytic indices and it in its interpretation, and how will help for the we people during the diagnose the case of the dogs. Now collective consideration of hemoglobin, RBC, packed then MCV, MCH, MCHC, ESR, the packed cell volume, number of RBC, then the volume is volume will be counted by MCV, then concentration by MCH, then MCHC, ESR. So all these parameters to be counted to consider the erythrocytic indices. Now factors which are affecting the HCT, then the hemoglobin concentration and RBC count. Now the first, the change in circulating RBC masses affects parameters. So if there is a change in the circulating RBC masses, mass in the parameters, then low values will occur in anemia. So everybody knows the low values can be observed in anemia, and all these three parameters may be disproportionate to each other. There may be a change in size, there may be the change in the content of the hemoglobin, and everything is altered. So then the second one is the increased RBC mass. So it can be called as absolute polycythemia, or the it could be the relative polycythemia, increased RBC masses. So if there is a dehydration is there, then the excitement induced splenic contraction. Say for example, the very much excitement is there in dog. So in that case, there is a chances of release of spleen, or there is a splenic contraction, and that lead to the increase in the polycythemia. Now, another factor is a dehydration. Excessive dehydration will lead to the hemoconcentration, and that hemoconcentration will increase the the chances of polycythemia. Then sitewood breeds such as the greyhounds, saluki, whippets, then the afghan hounds, they are normally having the higher HCT packed cell volume than the other breeds. So it is more oftenly observed, and it's about 60. Then changes in plasma volume affects all three parameters. Therefore, interpretation must be made with the knowledge of the patient's hydration status. So generally, when we are sending the samples, generally, if we are sending samples after the excessive dehydration or excessive hydration also, so on both these things may lead to the change in the total erythrocytic indices. So if the more volume of solutions or salines has been given to the particular dog, then there are chances of the anemia, or the relative type of anemia can be observed. Then the dehydration or fluid shift to the visceral organs will increase the NDICS values. So all values may be increased because of the dehydration or the shift of the fluid into the visceral organs. Say for example, if there is a disparity in the electrolyte imbalance, or if there is an electrolyte imbalance, in there are chances of the dehydration, tissue dehydration could be observed. Then the chronic peritonitis will be there. So the fluid from the main blood stream will be reached into the peritoneal cavity, similarly into the perfusion into the thoracic cavity. So in all these cases, there are chances of the inflammatory exudation or exudation can be observed during the course of some of the diseases that lead to the dehydration into the cellular level, and there is a loss of fluid that lead to the increase the these values. Then overhydration by giving the parenteral salines fluids can reduce the values of the erythrocytic NDICS and maybe look similar to the anemia, but it is exactly not anemia, but because of the overhydration of the saline, that may lead to the these kind of alterations that can be observed as a decrease in the hemoglobin concentration, and all these factors are the nothing but the changes in the erythrocytic NDICS. Now factors affecting the MCV, mean corpuscular hemoglobin, volume, can be changed with the some of the conditions. So reticulocytosis is one of the conditions. In that condition, there is a increased size of RBC. So there is a ultimately increased volume of RBCs. Then reticulocytes, particularly in the early form, are larger cells. So immature, we can say these cells which are not completed its maturation, they can come into the circulation. These kind of things can be observed in the at around second or third or fourth day of the acute hemorrhagic anemia or any kind of acute anemia. So reticulocytosis can be observed, and in such type of anemias, there is a change in the MCV. Then immature animals, most of the species have a smallest erythrocytes and microcyte, or the microcytosis is there, means the low MCV will be there. This also could reflect iron deficiency also. In iron deficiency anemias, some of the young animals will have the immature type of or the having the less iron, and that lead to the decrease in the MCV. The more there is a change in the volume of RBC, ultimately change in the concentration of the MCV. Then iron deficiency causes microcytosis and increased cell division that can be observed in the bone marrow, and whatever the cells are there, they are in of a smaller size. So whenever there is a deficiency of the iron, the synthesis of DNA is or the cell division, it's at a little stage or at the little stage, and that lead to the microcytic or microcytosis, and ultimately the MCV will be less in such conditions. So iron then the young animal should be considered. So while sending the samples, we must have that kind of history, that and the age of animal, and what is the physiological state of animal. So accordingly we can go forward for the this kind of anemias or the identification of mean corpuscular volume. Then microcytosis occurs in dog with the portosystemic venous shunt. Then the healthy Asian breeds of the dogs like Akita, then the Chow Chow, Sherpi, and Shibuya, they are openly having the microcytic erythrocytes. So it's natural, it's not a pathological conditions in these species or in these breeds. Then greyhounds normally have higher MCV than the non-greyhounds. That may be due to their erythrocytic significant shortened lifespan, because these breeds are having only the 55 days of the lifespan. So generally other breeds are having the more lifespan, and accordingly these species will have only 55 days of lifespan. That may lead to the change, continuous RBCs are in the maturation stage, and that lead to the macrocytosis, or we can say the reticulocytes are more, and that lead to the increased mean corpuscular volume. Then interference with the nucleic acid synthesis can cause an inhibition of the cell division and thereby larger cells. So it is the same thing. Whenever there is an interference with the maturation of the RBC, the RBCs will become in a as a larger RBC in the circulation. That's why the mean corpuscular volume will be increased. Then macrocytic anemia from an inherited selective intestinal malabsorption of the cyanocobalamin or vitamin B12 has been documented in the giant scissors. So every species will have B complex deficiency or the vitamin B12 deficiency lead to the macrocytic type of anemia. Then congenital microcytosis can be observed in poodles. Then erythrocyte agglutination can cause a false increase in the MCV. So erythrocyte agglutination can cause a false increase in MCV. So many factors which lead to the agglutination of erythrocytes, that includes the mainly the acute phase reaction. It could be occur because of the so many conditions that may we'll discuss at a later stage. So erythrocyte sedimentation rate or agglutination will enhance the MCV. Now factors affect the MCH, mean corpuscular hemoglobin and mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration. So they can affect in the similar way. Therefore, the MCH offers little additional hematological information concerning the patient. Now MCH is influenced by MCV. For example, a smaller erythrocytes contains less hemoglobin. It's natural. Then therefore, they have a decreased MCH. So MCH will be less in case of the microcytic type of anemia. In some of the cases of iron deficiency anemia, the MCH may decrease before MCH get decreased. So it's a one hand in hand, we can say. This is another index. In this index, it is not generally used in the classification of anemia. So generally, this index is generally not used for the class of MCH and MCHC cannot be used because there is not a consistent type of things can be observed. So if the MCHC and MCH are deeper, interpretation of the hemoglobin concentration should be based upon the MCHC, because the MCHC have a little bit correct cell volume, but the MCH will not have the correct cell volume. So that's why, so beyond this, MCHC and MCH should not be considered during the classification of anemia. No factors affecting MCHC. So here I can say some of the errors can become for the collection of the during the collection of samples. So increased MCHC is usually result in the in vitro or in vivo hemolysis or treatment with the oxyglobin. Then the both intra and extra cellular hemoglobins measured in the hemoglobin procedures. But the formula assumes all hemoglobin in is intracellular, giving high false value. So these are the things can be observed for the MCHC. So say for example, if the unfortunately in the tube some water is there, a little bit water is there. So that water may cause a little bit hemolysis while collecting the samples. Generally, if we don't have sometimes the or there may be the chances of the hemolysis while collecting the samples, or the if the aperture of needle is very small, then we are putting the collected samples into the vial with the force. At that time, some of the RBCs get hemolyzed, so that will come under the in vitro type of things. So these are the collecting errors, and that may lead to the change in the MCHC. A true MCHC can be increased and does not normally occur. So true MCHC, higher MCHC generally not observed. Increased concentration of the hemoglobin cannot be produced within the cell. So the within cell, these things cannot be happened. Then reticulocytes do not have their full component of the hemoglobin. So as everybody knows, the reticulocytes are the immature type of RBCs and they are come in circulation. They don't have the full component of the hemoglobin. Therefore, the MCHC may be decreased in the reticulocytosis. Whenever there is a excess of reticulocytes are there, or the large number of reticulocytes are there in the blood circulation, that may lead to the change in the MCHC. Then hypochromasia or hypochroma, that lead to the low MCHC. That occurs in some of the cases of the iron deficiency. Whenever there is a iron deficiency, the chroma means the color of the RBC or the content of the chroma is less, and that lead to the deficiency or that may lead to the low MCHC. Then MCHC may not be low in iron deficient dogs when measured in some electronic arm. So there are some controversy about this. So some counters may count, some counters may not count. So we can't. So basically, the MCHC should not be considered as a criteria or the MCH. Both the things should not be considered as a criteria for the classification of the anemia. So MCV is a good material or the good parameters can be considered while classify the anemias. Now the another factors that when we get this some results, so generally we are observing one value, that RDW. What is that RDW? So red cell distribution width. So this is a one of the erythrocytic indices. It is an index of the degree of anisocytosis or variation in the size of the erythrocytes. Then reticulocytes may result in increased RDW. So as we know, the reticulocytes having the larger surface area. So once there is a larger surface area, that may lead to the increase the RDW. Then rollers formation are a group of erythrocyte assembling a track over the like a coins. The degree of rollers formation tends to positively correlate with the erythrocyte sedimentation rate. So whenever there is an increased rollers formation, there is ultimately increase in the erythrocytic sedimentation rate. And it is usually associated with an altered surface membrane charge. So whatever the zeta potential is there, so there is a change in the charges of the surface of the RBC, and that lead to the aggregation of two RBC together. So once there is an aggregation of two RBC together, there is a more settling down will be observed, and ESR will be more in such cases, and ultimately that will be changed the RDW values. The intensity of these charges can be a species characteristic in some of the cases, characteristic of the some of the disease as well as in the some of the species also. So most of the disease conditions which are having the inflammatory conditions, all these conditions will lead to the increased ESR rates. Ultimately, there is a rollers formation or the adhesion of one or the adherence of the one RBC to the another RBC, that lead to the increased erythrocyte sedimentation rate, and ultimately we can see the ESR has been increased because of the increase in zeta potential. In certain diseases, normal membrane surface charges may be partially masked by the excess of proteins. So more fibrin, then the more globulin. So hyperfibrinogenemia and hyperglobulinemia. So all these two conditions will lead to decrease the repelling negative surface charges on the RBC. So generally, the RBC are present in the population, they are with the negatively charged type of connect each other, or they are not adhere to each other, but with the presence of more amount of fibrinogen in the blood circulation or more globulin in the blood circulation, the change in the charge of over the surface of RBC, and that lead to the activation of this surface and areas, and there is a formation of the aggregations, and that lead to the increased ESR. Then chronic inflammatory conditions, maybe the bacterial infections, acute phase reaction, all these type of infections, inflammations that lead to the increased ESR. Erythrocyte sedimentation rate will be increased in this type of conditions. anemia. Anemia, so based on the morphological classification, we will have the normocytic normochromic anemia, normocytic hypochromic anemia, macrocytic normochromic anemia, macrocytic hypochromic anemia, then the microcytic normochromic and microcytic hypochromic. So depending upon the size of RBC and content of hemoglobin. So this classification is based on the size of RBC and content of the hemoglobin into the RBC. If the content is less, we can call it as a hypochromic. If the content is more if the size is more, we can call it as macrocytic. So this is the another classification or the classification of anemia. Then the classification of anemia based on the etiological factor. So as we know, there are different factors are there, etiological factors that lead to the classification of anemia. Hemolytic anemia, so hemolysis may be intravascular or extravascular. Intravascular hemolysis can be observed because of the so many toxins are there, poisons are there, snake bites are there. So that lead to the intravascular hemolysis. Then phosphorus and the babesia, if the exponential or the large numbers of pyroplasm or large number of parasites present in the RBC, then and then only the intravascular hemolysis can be observed in case of the dogs. Then most of the sensitized RBCs are removed from the circulation, and that is also called as the extravascular hemolysis. So the opsonization of the RBCs will take place. The infected RBCs will be recognized by the mononuclear phagocytic system, and these opsonized RBCs are removed from the circulation. Ultimately, there is a hemolysis, that is the extravascular hemolysis. Then the second etiological classification or the second factor for the etiological anemia is the acute and chronic hemorrhagic anemia. So hemorrhagic anemia, hemorrhages may be the within the body or outside the body. Within the body, generally we are observing within the body hemorrhages can be observed in the many conditions. And one of the common conditions is the peptic ulcer in the dogs. So last by giving some non-steroidal drugs for a longer period, then the chronic renal failure, in all these conditions there is a development of the ulcers in the stomach, and that ulcers may lead to the continuous bleeding, and that lead to the internal bleeding, and acute or chronic type of hemorrhages can be observed. Then some of the parasitic infections, generally whenever there is a ankusarka, there are chances of the rupture of aorta along with the esophagus, and that may lead to the extensive blood loss, and the anemia, hemorrhagic type of anemia can be observed. Then hemorrhagic anemia, acute hemorrhagic anemia may be observed because of the accident, then the rupture of some of the blood vessels, that lead to the hemorrhagic type of anemias. Then the dyshemopoietic anemia, so here bone marrow affections, then the most of the deficiency symptoms or the deficiency of the all material which is required for the production of RBC. That may include the proteins, that may include the minerals, that may include the metalloproteins, that may include the amino acids, the zinc, then the copper, then the all B complexes. All these things are required for the production of RBC. Then the whenever there are the different abnormalities in the liver, abnormalities in the intestines, so all these abnormalities in the intestines will be called as a enteropathies. Whenever there is a enteropathies, say for example the chronic inflammatory reaction of the intestines, so whenever there is a chronic inflammatory reaction of the intestines, that lead to the thickening of the lamina propria, and once there is a thickness of the lamina propria, there is a improper absorption of the nutrients which are given orally to the dogs. So that nutrients may have the amino acids, the all minerals, then the all trace minerals. Those are important for the multiplication of the erythroid cells and the production of RBC. So dyshemopoietic anemia can be observed because of the we can say the enteropathies. Then liver dysfunction, so ultimately whatever the we are giving food to the dogs, ultimately it could get absorbed and will go to the liver for the further analysis and the further transformation. So the simple products will convert into the complex products will convert into the simple, and this that will be go to the liver, and again the liver will convert into the some simple product in the complex, and complex into the simple products. So whenever there is a dysfunction of the liver, that liver may lead to the absence of some proteins which are essential for the production of RBC. Amino acids, then the amino acids are not produced by the liver, then ultimately the bone marrow will be suppressed. Then kidney dysfunctions, the, as we know, erythropoietin is required for the stimulation and the production of RBC. Erythropoietin hormone is essential for this. So once there is a deficiency of erythropoietin, maybe the acute one or chronic one. So that lead to the dyshemopoietic anemia because of the absence of erythropoietin, which is required for the multiplication of erythroblast or the multipotent hematocytoplast. Then the second classification of anemia is based on the regeneration power of the bone marrow. So again, the two classes are there: regenerative anemia and non-regenerative anemias. So regenerative anemia means it is helpful. We can say regenerative anemia is good type of anemia. Non-regenerative anemia is a generally a dangerous type of anemia, and slowly the dogs undergo the severe anemic conditions and finally may die because of the multiple edema development in the various parts of body or body cavities. And a classical example of the non-regenerative anemia is a chronic renal failure. So as we know, in chronic renal failure, erythropoietin is not produced because of the most of the tubular epithelial cells or the JG cells around the glomeruli are affected. They are not producing erythropoietin, and that erythropoietin will not reach towards the bone marrow and RBCs will not be generated. In such type of anemias or in such type of conditions, there is a normocytic normochromic anemia. So the progressive, there is an anemia, but there is no change in the size of RBC. There is no decrease in the size of RBC or no change, no observation of any reticulocytes in the circulation, no any nucleated RBCs in the circulation. So all these things lead to the non-regenerative anemia. But regenerative anemia is considered as a good type of, or the good recovery from the anemia. If the anemia is there, maybe the hemolytic, hemorrhagic, or any kind of anemia having the a quite good amount of the numbers of the reticulocytes in the circulation, then we can say it's a good and the bone marrow is active. Now, the how to interpret the results once we have the some reports with us. Now, how to interpret the RDW, reticulocytes with the anisocytosis and increase RDW. So whenever you get the results with you, the reticulocytes with anisocytosis and increase RDW, then macrocytosis, increase MCV, then hypochromasia. So these three things should be considered together, and this will be observed in the good type of bone marrow. The bone marrow is active and the RDW is a little bit at a higher side. So if the RDW is lesser side, then it will be the some problem. But whenever there is RDW is more, then we can say that the bone marrow is active. Then ME ratio, the myeloid and erythroid ratio. So hypercellular bone marrow with a decreased ME ratio due to the erythroid hyperplasia. Now, whenever there is a demand, more demand in the circulation, say for example, whenever there is a extensive hemorrhagic anemia or hemolytic anemia, the most of the RBCs are get lost from the circulation. There is a decreased number of RBC. In response to that, hypoxia is developed at the kidney tubules. Whenever there is a development of hypoxia at kidney tubules, they release the erythropoietin. That erythropoietin will go to the bone marrow and it stimulates the activation or the mitosis, we can say, the multiplication cycle of the erythroid cells, and the there is a apoptosis of the some of the myeloid cells and increased number of the erythroid cells. So in case of anemia, the hypercellular bone marrow with a decreased ME ratio. So myeloid cells will be less, erythroid cells will be more. So that can be observed in case of the regenerative type of anemia. But in case of non-regenerative type of anemia, there is a lack of erythroid response, and ultimately you will have the different pictures. So myeloid erythroid ratio will be different in these structures, or the different in the that particular patient. Then microscopic observations of the different conditions of the erythrocytes, polychromasia. Polychroma means the poly, different type of color. We can say the, we may say that East German color can be observed in the RBCs. Some RBCs are bright red in color, bright pink in color. Then some RBCs are having the little bit bluish tinge, and sometimes there is a presence of some, the chromatin type of material can be present, or like a sprinkle. They can be present over the surface of RBC. Then there sometimes there may be some greenish type of discoloration. So all these conditions are called as a polychromasia. So multiple color can be observed in a single blood smear. So at one site you can say some bright red RBC, some are the pink type of RBC, some RBCs are the bluish, sometimes greenish type of RBCs can be observed. Then another observation is the hinge bodies. The hinge bodies can be observed in hemolytic type of conditions. Then spherocytes, the immunological type of reactions can be observed whenever there is a spherocytes. Then nucleated RBCs. Nucleated RBCs are the indications of the good bone marrow. If the more number of nucleated RBCs are there, it is an indication of the good bone marrow or active bone marrow. Such cases will be respond to the your treatment, and your treatment is going on a good directions. If unfortunately, if the NRBCs are not there, no reticulocytes are there, and the animal is still showing the normocytic normochromic anemia, then it is a problem, and it could be the some bone marrow depressions, maybe the kidney failure, then the x-rays or the, sorry, not x-ray, the radiations and some of the chemicals or the long-standing antibiotics may lead to the aplastic bone marrow, and or sometimes we are using the cyclophosphamides like drugs for the some cancer therapies. So in such, or radiation therapies, in such conditions, the inactive bone marrow may be observed, and we are getting that kind of result. Now you can see NRBC, nucleated RBC. So RBCs will have nucleus inside it. In image, whenever there is an immune-mediated hemolytic anemias, whenever there is an immune-mediated hemolytic anemias, so these type of cells, so we can say this is a one cell, or the, it is nucleated RBC. All these four, 1, 2, 3, 4, all are the nucleated RBCs, and it is an indication of active bone marrow. Now the, you can see why we are calling that as the immune mediated anemia. So if you see carefully, these some of the RBCs, they are having very small vacuoles, small structures are there, very small vacuoles are observed on the surface of RBCs. So these small vacuoles are observed because of the MAC, or the membrane attacking complex. So whenever there is an immunological reaction initiated in the body, there is a formation of some complement reaction, and that complement reaction ultimately there is a formation of the membrane attacking complex, and when these complexes are circulating into the general circulation, they will affect over the surface of RBC, and RBC will have the very smaller type of this tiny vacuolated non-chromatic type of areas. So these particular areas are the non-chromatic, so very small areas. Here also we can see some of the RBCs are having a very small non-chromatic areas. So that is indication of there is a presence of some membrane attacking complex, and that lead to the, or the, it generally observed in the immune-mediated hemolytic immune-mediated type of anemias. Then reticulocytes. So you can observe reticulocytes with the different type of stains. Ramanowski stain can be used for the reticulocytes. So reticulocytes will have the off color, or the little bit less chroma, as we know, less chroma, and you can see some of the remnants of the RNA, they are observed over the surface of RBC. So this type of reticulocytes can be observed. So after erythrocytic indices, we can shift ourselves towards the leukocytes. In leukocytic indices, we have the total leukocytic count, and in total leukocytic count, generally there are two possibility. There is a leukocytosis and leukocytopenia. Leukocytosis and leukocytopenia, or sometimes total leukocytic counts are within the normal range. So leukocytosis can be observed physiologically and pathologically. Now physiological leukocytosis can be observed in most of the animals, or in case of dogs, after meal, after giving food to the dogs. Generally, there is an increase in the total leukocytic counts during the pregnancy, during the lactation, and physical exercise. So all these conditions may lead to the increase leukocytic count. Then pathological conditions, multiple factors. So leukocytosis can be observed because of the any kind of inflammation, then the bacterial type of infections, any type of injury, immunological reactions, vaccine reactions, then the active bone marrows, then the sometimes the long-standing steroids. So all these conditions lead to the leukocytosis. Then leukocytopenia, the leukocytopenia can be observed in the bone marrow affections, the septic shock, whenever the capacity of the first line of defense is exhausted. So say for example, the, if the large number of or the heavy concentration of the infection is there, the sepsis is developed and the antigen or the toxins, they are circulated into the body, definitely the they are beyond the limit of the leukocytes. So the some of the cells or the bone marrow will be suppressed, and the that can be observed in a septic shock. Then some of the viral infection, they lead to the leukocytopenia. Now neutrophils, we have the neutropenia and neutrophilia. Neutropenia will be the decrease in number of the neutrophils. Neutrophilia, increased number of neutrophils. Eosinopenia generally not observed, but eosinopenia is not observed, but eosinophilia can be observed in some of the allergic conditions, then the parasitic infestation. And as we know, the eosinophils plays important role during the any kind of inflammatory reaction, then the hypersensitivity. So in all these conditions, there are chances of eosinophilia. Then basophils, basophilia generally not observed because already the concentration of basophil is 0 to 1%. Basophilia can be observed in some of the tumorous conditions. Then most of the times we are dealing with the lymphocytopenia and lymphocytosis. Lymphocytopenia and lymphocytosis are the common conditions observed in case of dogs at various pathological conditions. Lymphocytopenia may be observed in some of the viral conditions. Then lymphocytosis can be observed in most of the parasitic infections and long-standing inflammatory conditions that may lead to the lymphocytosis. Then the monocytes, monocytopenia generally not remain unnoticed, but monocytosis can be noticed. Monocytosis, increased number of monocytes. So again, it is an indication of the chronic inflammatory reactions. Now we'll see another thing in that the progressively more immature neutrophils. So we can say the metamyeloblast, myelocytes or the promyelocytes may encode in the blood picture in some of the conditions whenever there is a severe inflammation and myeloid leukemia. So in case of the myeloid leukemia, you can observe the increased total leukocytic count and increase the myeloid type of cells or the increase more number of neutrophils in the circulation. Now increase the more means how much more. Now say for example, in case of the pyometra, in case of dogs, I have observed some of the cases, they can show the total leukocytic count up to the 60,000. So 60,000 total leukocytic count can be observed in such cases. After careful examination, then the with the help of USG, then the you can go for the exploratory laparotomy. So ultimately you can shift yourself towards the pyometra. So in pyometra, most of the times the total leukocytic count means whatever I observed up till now, the most of the times the total leukocytic counts is remain above the 30,000 per cubic millimeter. And may some of the cases I observed about the 60,000 total leukocytic count per cubic millimeter. So if the 60,000 count is there, sometimes it may confuse ourselves that it may be the myeloid tumor, but after careful examination, the pyometra is there. If the pyometra is not there, you can go for USG, maybe the liver abscess, maybe the peritonitis, suppurative peritonitis or the suppurative type of pneumonia, pleurisy, fibrosis of the lungs, then the suppurative fibrosis, we can say, addition of lungs. So in all these conditions, extensive suppurative inflammation, suppurations, the total leukocytic count may be higher in such type of conditions. Now, if the count is go near to the 1 lakh count along with the neutrophilia, more than 90% of neutrophilia in circulation. So in such conditions, we can say that the condition or that dog may be suffering from the myeloid leukemia. So the total leukocyte count may go beyond 90,000. Then you can say, and along with that, the there is a presence of immature cells, metamyelocytes, myelocytes, and the promyelocytes in the circulation. Then this type of things can be considered as a myeloid type of leukemia. Then toxic changes in neutrophils, cytoplasmic basophilia, cytoplasmic vacuolation. Now these three conditions are the typical type of conditions can be observed in various type of bacterial infections, especially whenever there is a gram-negative type of infections, and septicemia and toxemia can be observed. In that conditions, there are chances of the toxic changes in the neutrophils. So toxic changes means there is a presence of some the small granules into the neutrophils. Then cytoplasmic basophilia, there is a change in the basophilia. Generally the cytoplasm of neutrophil is pink in color, but because of the severe inflammatory conditions, severe toxic changes into the blood circulation, there is a change in basophilia. The more enzymatic reactions can take place into the cytoplasm, and that lead to the retention of more proteins, and more protein lead to the retention of some chromatin material, and that chromatin material will be remain as it is, and that lead to the decreased eosinophilia, and the cells will look like a basophils, or the basophilia will be observed. So that is the cytoplasmic basophilia. Then cytoplasmic vacuolation. So sometimes the whenever there is a phagocytic procedure, phagocytosis observed, there is a continuous going on phagocytic procedure, maybe the bacteria, maybe the some of the antigens, or maybe the circulatory type of things, whenever they are circulating into the blood circulation, there are chances of the phagocytic reactions can take place within the blood circulation. During that, there is a regurgitation of the enzymes into the cytoplasm of the leukocytes. Regurgitation, or the whenever the phagocytosis takes place, some of the enzymes get leak into the cytoplasm, and that lead to the hydrolysis or the lysis of the some of the proteins, that lead to the formation of the vacuolation into the cytoplasm of the neutrophils. Now neutrophils, whenever there is a hypersegmentation of neutrophils, so whenever there is a hypersegmentation of neutrophils, it is an indication of long standing corticosteroid therapy. Then the hyperadrenocorticism and or the late stage of the chronic inflammatory reactions. Now if the abscess is formed, say for example the injury is there, we are doing the some operations, and unfortunately the abscess is formed. So in that conditions, the abscess, whenever abscess is formed, the pyogenic membranes are formed, and once the pyogenic membranes are formed, we can see the hypersegmented cells into the general circulation. So if you go for the day by day observation of the leukocytes, especially neutrophils, after doing the operations or the as a follow-up therapy, you can see the hypersegmentation in the leukocytes, especially neutrophils. So this is indication of the chronic inflammatory reaction and formation of pyogenic membrane. So whenever there are abscess formation, then the corticosteroid therapy and hyperadrenocorticism, in all these conditions, neutrophil segments are more. How many more? More than 5 segments. So generally, up to the 5 segments, the most of the cells will be more than 5 segments of the neutrophils. Then neutrophil nuclear hypersegmentation. Hypersegment means the one condition is a hypersegmentation, another is a hypersegmentation. Hypo means less number of segments. So especially hereditary can be observed in the Australian Shepherds, then Coons and the Exhounds. So in all these species or all these breeds, we can see the naturally or the inheritory type of less number of segment of the neutrophils. Now in case of canine distemper, we can see some of the, as we know, the canine distempers are virus are able to produce the inclusion bodies in all germinal epithelial cells, including the leukocytes as well as the in the RBCs also. So here I have shown one of the cells. In case of canine distempers, you can see very small type of inclusion bodies are observed in the cytoplasm of the neutrophil. So the what I want to say exactly, the while going for the interpretation of the leukocytes, we must go for the leukocytic count. As we may get leukocytosis, maybe the as it is maybe physiological, maybe pathological. Then if you get the leukocytopenia, we have to go shift our diagnosis towards the identification of some of the bone marrow affections. Then we must observe further some septic shock, then viral complications. So all these things, then the neutrophilia, neutropenia, eosinophilia, then the basophilia, lymphocytosis, lymphocytopenia, monocytosis and monocytopenia. Then progressive immature segments, they are observed because of the immature type of things. Immature can be observed either because of the pyometra, or it can be observed because of the myeloid type of infections. So myeloid type of leukemia. So in that case, the total leukocyte count is more than the 90,000. Then toxic neutrophils, cytoplasmic basophilia, cytoplasmic vasculitis. Now all these things, they come through only. So because the machine will not show this type of things. So cytoplasmic basophilia will not be counted by the machines. The cytoplasmic vasculitis will not be counted by the machine. Then toxic neutrophils cannot be diagnosed by the machines. For this purpose, we must go for the peripheral blood smear or the blood smear of the whatever blood we have. So we have to prepare blood smear, go for the either Lissman stain, Ramanowski stain or the Jimsa stain, whatever the stain we are using. We should observe each and every cell very carefully for the coming to the final conclusion of the that particular disease condition. Now the after that, because this all these things cannot be diagnosed by the machine, so my intention is that, so just not sending the sample to the laboratory, it's better you try at your own and try to find out some of the morphological conditions. So on the hand, or the hand in hand, you will have the accurate interpretation of the result at the site of the maybe the operation theater or the, at the your clinic. So neutrophils will be look like this. The you can see the increased basophilia. So the basophilia will be look like this. So all these cells are the showing the pink cytoplasm, but this cell will have the little bit more type of basophilia, the blue cytoplasm. So these are the things can be identified only by the observation of the accurate blood smears. Now lymphocytes generally we have the lymphocytosis and lymphocytopenia. Lymphocytopenia can be observed because of the maybe the corticosteroid therapy, long acting steroid therapy. Then immunocytes can be observed into the many type of immunological reactions, or the as a output of immunological reaction. Then sometimes there is a presence of lymphoblast. Then the cytoplasmic inclusion can be observed, and no doubt the parasites can be observed into the lymphocytes. So parasites generally, the tick fever, ehrlichiosis can be diagnosed, or they can be present. Then the H. canis can be present in the leukocytes, in the neutrophils also, and lymphocytes also. So the immunocytes and the lymphoblast are the most important things to be diagnosed at the to go for some conclusions. Now immunocytes will be present into the general circulation whenever there is a antigen antibody reactions. Antigen antibody reactions can, whenever they are present in the body. So immunocytes, they are present in more into the circulation. Now lymphoblast, if the large number of lymphoblasts are there, and along with that the total leukocytic count is more, and ultimately if there is a more lymphocytic count is there, so then such type of things will be considered, or the will be suspected for the lymphosarcoma or lymphoma. So in this condition we can see there is an increased lymphocytic count. Then eosinophilia, generally eosinophilia can be observed because of the increased number of eosinophils, the immunological reaction, hypersensitivity sensitivity reaction, and parasitic type of infections. So there is a increased eosinophilic count. Then basophilia generally observed in some of the tumors. Platelets, generally these type of platelets, based on the platelet interpretation, we are considering so many conditions. So thrombocytosis, thrombocytopenia. Now thrombocytosis means the increased number of platelets, thrombocytopenia, decreased number of platelets. Now platelets, so there are different parameters of the platelets. When we go for the machine, we are getting some cheat, or the we are getting some type of content or the parameters, that MPV, mean platelet volume, like the PCV or MCV. In the same fashion, we have MPV, that is mean platelet volume. Mean platelet volume is measured in FL and is determined by the impedance and the optical particle counter. So it is nothing but the machine, then the, or the machine aperture and the solutes or the diluents that can be used. Then MPV reflects the average size of platelet. That is most important for us. So MPV means the average size of platelet in the circulating blood. MPV generally inversely proportional to the platelet number. If the platelet number are less, then MPV will be more. So inversely proportional to the number of platelets, MPV will be more. Increase MPV with the thrombocytopenia. So whenever there is thrombocytopenia, MPV will be more, suggest responsive thrombopoiesis. Erythropoiesis, we know that reticulocytes are more in a size of reticulocytes are more. In the same fashion, whenever the immature platelets are coming in the circulation, they are having the more amount or the more volume, and that's why but the number is less. The more volume is there, but the number is less. So that is indication of the responsive thrombopoiesis. The good thrombopoiesis is there, and that is the good indication for the inflammatory reaction as well as the healing process of the conditions. Then the larger platelets, giant platelets, nascent platelets are fully functional and usually hyper responsive. MPV greater than 10 FL indicates normal to increase megakaryopoiesis in bone marrow with a 96 positive predictive value. Now we can say predictive value means it's a responsive. The more than 12 FL is indication of the normal active bone marrow. Decrease karyocytes, lack of megakaryocyte response, bone marrow failure. So ultimately, whenever there is a kidney failure cases or the immune-mediated thrombocytopenia. So whenever there is a formation of antibodies against the platelets, that lead to the formation of antibodies against the platelets, and such type of platelets can be removed from the circulation. In the same fashion, whatever the megakaryocytes present into the bone marrow will be suppressed by this antigen antibody complexes or antigen reaction, and ultimately the thrombopoiesis will be hampered. Now increased MPV should be expected in the disorders with the responsive thrombopoiesis. Now immune-mediated thrombocytopenia, then the megakaryocytes number and the morphology should be evaluated in bone marrow aspiration. Then especially in the patient with the low MPV and the thrombocytopenia, and there are chances of the failure of the bone marrow associated with the lack of megakaryocytes response and bone marrow failure. So that can be observed. Then the aspirated, especially in patient with the low MPV and the thrombocytopenia, or the patient with the failed to respond to treatment. Now if the immunological reaction is there, or any kind of reaction is there, and though you are giving so many things, but if there is no response to that, then there is a low type of MPV, and it's quite dangerous for the healing procedure or the to maintain the integrity of the endothelial cells or everything. The platelets are required for most of the functions of the body. Now platelet spare and swell. Now what are some of the factors which are responsible for the during the storage? now the platelets pair and swell in EDTA anticoagulant blood samples and stored at more than 4 hours cooled or room temperature 25 degrees centigrade or refrigerator. Now whenever we are collecting sample in EDTA, there are chances of increase in the size of platelets because of the EDTA, and there is a swelling of the platelets and the rounding of sparing and the rounding of platelets can be observed because of the storage or the use of the EDTA. Then swelling may be result in an artificially high MPV. Then platelets retain their native discoid shape and have a minimal MPV change when collected in saturated anticoagulant and stored at even 37 degrees centigrade. Now, if we are using this citrate instead of EDTA, then the morphology of the platelet will be remain as it is. Now, you can take two samples, one sample in EDTA, one sample in citrate. So, citrate will not change the morphology as well as the not change the total MPV values of the platelets, but the EDTA may change the MPV values. So, sometimes we may be in the confusion that the platelets are showing the high things or lower things. So these are the things which are responsible for that. So the storage capacity or the storage material, then the how to send to the laboratory either through EDTA or citrate. So these things should be considered while sending sample to the laboratory and while interpreting the results. Now, reticulated platelets which contains increased RNA and have been released recently from the bone marrow. Now, the reticulated means like a reticulocytes, the platelets are having some the inclusions into the its body. So that is nothing but the remnants of RNA and can be observed, and we can consider that this platelet has come from the bone marrow less than 24 hours old, or the age of platelet can be counted as a 24 hours if the platelets are having that such type of the inclusions into the its body. They may be acquainted the quantified by the flow cytometric analysis or using the thiazole orange and the fluorescent dye that binds RNA, and increased reticulocyte platelets suggested responsive thrombopoiesis. Now, if you are getting more MPV and activated type of the platelets, it can be observed that the platelets are having the RNA, and it is nothing but the good response of the bone marrow, and it is an indication of the good thrombopoiesis. Now, towards the end of the session, we can consider so many things together. Now, for interpreting result, we must consider hemoglobin, then leukocytes, neutrophilia, thrombocytosis, then the acute infections. All these things should be considered together. So, all these while interpreting the results, not only single parameter should be considered. So we must consider the hemoglobin, if it is normal or abnormal. Now, decreased hemoglobin, we know that it is because of the anemia. Then as per the history that we have, we must have some history of fever, a long-standing fever, everything is with us. Then we can say the whatever the hemoglobin, expected hemoglobin. So once we expect that this hemoglobin should be like this, while observing the mucous membranes, we are saying that the hemoglobin may be about 6 gram percent, maybe 7 gram percent, 8 gram percent, because you people are most studious about this, and as you are handling large number of animals, so just by looking towards the mucous membrane, we can predict something that the hemoglobin concentration is like this. But along with that, we must consider the hydration status of the animal. If the hydration is more or hydration is less, if the omissions are continuously going on, diarrhea is continuously going on, in that case, though there is anemia, but because of the relative loss of fluid, there may be the chances of increase in hemoglobin concentration. So this thing should be considered while interpreting the hemoglobin concentration. So the hydration may be the external hydration or internal hydration. So or external dehydration, we can say the dehydration maybe because of omission, diarrhea, or hydration because of the giving saline. So in these conditions, we should consider hemoglobin in this for the interpretation of results. Then along with hemoglobin, we must consider the leukocytes. Are they in the normal range, or they are beyond the normal range, or they are below the normal range? Means either there may be leukocytosis or maybe the leukocytopenia. Now, if the hemoglobin are normal but the leukocytosis is there, and along with that, if the leukocytosis, along with that, neutrophilia is there, along with neutrophilia, if the thrombocytosis is there, then it is an indication of acute infection. So maybe the any kind of acute infection. So maybe the muscle injury, maybe the bacterial infection, maybe the some injury, maybe the burn injury, maybe the accidental injury, maybe the surgical wound. So in all these conditions, the hemoglobin level may be remain in the normal stage. Then there will be the leukocytosis. Along with that, neutrophilia is there, and along with as a response to that, the thrombocytosis is there. Now all these things, all these three or four parameters, they are having the their own inter linking or connections. Now whenever there is an inflammation, definitely the in body there is a first line of defense is nothing but the neutrophils. So ultimately, whenever there is a acute type of infection is there, neutrophils are in general circulation. So ultimately, we are getting the neutrophilia. So once there is a neutrophilia, whatever the pools or the storage of the neutrophils are there in the bone marrow, this bone marrows will get emptied. Or the, we can call it as a colony stimulating factor. So during the inflammation, colony stimulating factors will be released. The colony stimulating factors will be released into the blood circulation, go to the bone marrow, and through that, whatever the colonies of the bone marrows are there, they will be released into the circulation. Now, as we know, the neutrophils will be remain in the circulation from 24 to 48 hours. The 24 to 48 hours means they shift themselves in the various shifts. So, colony stimulating factors, they by the macrophages will go to the bone marrow. They can pull many neutrophils. Those are taking rest into the bone marrow. So because of that, there is a leukocytosis. Along with that, neutrophilia is there. And as the inflammatory reaction is there, so every inflammatory reaction is characterized by the somewhere or the little bit change into the vascular endothelial cells or the damage to the vascular endothelial cells. And as we know, vascular endothelial cells are more and more thrombogenic. Thrombogenic means it acts or the it attracts more thrombocytes. So whenever there is a damage to the vascular endothelial cells, more thrombocytes can be observed in the general circulation. Now again, the pool of thrombocytes can be come from the bone marrow. Whatever the storage tanks or the storage compartments of the bone marrows are there, they get emptied because of the this type of stimulus, and this stimulus is generally thrown towards the bone marrow with the help of interleukin. So last many interleukins are released in the acute inflammatory reaction, and that lead to the these kind of observations. So hemoglobin may be in the within the normal range, but if you are getting leukocytosis, then neutrophilia, thrombocytosis, so this is the indication of acute type of infection and inflammation. So inflammation and infections can be observed, so that come under acute conditions. Maybe the acute inflammation by the any kind of maybe injury, maybe bacteria, maybe sepsis, maybe burn, accident, blood loss. So everywhere you can see these kind of observations. Now this another type of observations that we are getting, the hemoglobin is less, the total leukocyte count may be within the normal range, but along with that, instead of neutrophilia, here if we are getting the lymphocytosis, it's a definitely indication of the some tick fever like conditions. Then early phase or in early stage, there is a marginal thrombocytopenia. The thrombocytes are marginal, means they are about to less, means marginal, we can say the marginal thrombocytopenia. And in the later stages, severe thrombocytopenia. So these are the indication of the tick fever. Now the if you are not going directly observation of the blood smear examination, but if you have the some result with you, but unfortunately the lab may not able to identify the tick fever parasites into the lymphocytes or the leukocytes the tick fever, especially I am talking about the ehrlichiosis. So whenever there is a little bit hemoglobin less, the normal leukocyte count, little bit lymphocytosis, marginal thrombocytopenia, and severe or the later on maybe severe thrombocytopenia. In all these conditions are suspected for the tick fever. So you can start with by looking towards the thrombocytopenia, you can start the typical treatment of our Ehrlichia in case of the dogs. Now after this we can see the acute phase reaction. As the acute phase reaction is a complex type of process. Now, in this case, there is a activation of membrane attacking complex. Then enzymes, multiple enzymes are involved in this. Then there is a formation of or the generation of interleukins. So this acute phase reaction, it generally, it is a characteristic feature of the many type of inflammatory reaction in the body. Many times the tick fevers, then the any kind of infection, the tumors, supurity type of inflammation, abscess formations, all this, then the long-standing pyometra, close pyometra, open pyometra, in all these condition, acute phase reaction can be observed. So the what exactly happened in the acute phase reaction? So in acute phase reaction, some of the heptaglobulins or the gamma globulins can be released into the circulation. So the globulinemia is there, and the globulins or the fibrinogen can be observed over the surface of RBC. These RBCs can be removed from the circulation, and there is a formation of RULAC. So in case of all acute phase reaction, you will get an increased ESR, erythrocyte sedimentation rate will be increased. As it is a complex process, it includes the so many tissues or the so many cells, especially we can say the vascular endothelial cells. Now say, for example, if the tumor is there, there is a continuous releasing of the some of the tumor associated antigen or the tumor non-associated antigen or the cell specific or the tumor specific antigen, they are released into the circulation. So these antigens can be present over the surface of RBCs. Then these antigens may circulate in freely circulate into the blood circulation. So these antigens could be identified by the phagocytic systems. That antigen will be processed into the leukocytes, and as a result of that, the acute phase reaction, again, once there is a increased phagocytic activity, again there is a release of more interleukins, and the progressive type of reactions can be observed in the acute phase reaction. Now in case of tick fever, the earlier in early phase of tick fever, you will get the thrombocytosis, and in the later stage you will get the thrombocytopenia. Now why this has happened? Because the some of the morulae or some of the infections or the stages of the Ehrlichia can come through the platelets. So as a result of that, there are increased consumption of platelets. So though the number of platelets are more in the circulation, but the actual count of the platelets, because whatever the platelets are there, they are engaged somewhere. So as we know, one of the clinical signs of the tick fever is a rashes or the bleeding at the mucous membranes or the skin. So it is because of the platelets, though they are present in the circulation, they are in the form of clumps. They are not utilized by the for the normal function of the hemostasis. So whenever there is a tick fever like conditions, you are getting the acute phase reaction, and again the complications are continuously going on in acute phase reaction. And finally, if we are not giving the proper treatment or the exact treatment in such conditions, these conditions will be converted into the chronic renal failure or the chronic hepatic failures, and ultimately the animals may undergo the multi organ failure. So acute phase reaction, it start with the inflammatory reaction and it ends with the deposition of some antigen antibody complexes, as well as the deposition of the some remnants of the disintegration of the cells, and ultimately the kidneys is mostly affected by the late stage of the acute phase reaction. So the identification of different structures, different pathological conditions in body with the help of the acute phase reactions, with the help of another tools, say for example the tumors are there, supurity inflammations are there, you can go for the USG x-rays. Then the tick fever could be diagnosed with the based on the very good blood smear examination. Especially you can observe the leukocytes as well as you can observe the platelets also. So these are the some of the output of the acute phase reactions and the some of the interpretation things. Then we can see the another pictures that we are commonly observed, the leukocytosis, thrombocytosis followed by thrombocytopenia, then progressive anemia, increased bleeding tendency, and high ESR. So these are the typical type of findings in case of the tick fever. Especially I am talking about the Ehrlichiosis. In Ehrlichia we can see the leukocytosis, then the thrombocytosis, followed by thrombocytopenia. In early phase, thrombocytosis and progressive anemia, because just we have discussed there is a deposition of some of the heptaglobulins over the surface of RBCs. Then they, there is a change in the osmolarity of the RBC, and RBCs are removed from the circulation because of the another effect of the acute phase reaction. Then increased bleeding tendency as the platelets are there, but they are not engaged for the maintain their normal physiological function. That's why there are increased bleeding tendency. So the thrombocytosis followed by thrombocytopenia and leukocytosis, then the peripheral lymphocytosis you can observe, and ultimately we can see the increased ESR, and ultimately we can say that this is a case of tick fever. Okay, so this is about the things that I want to share with you. Definitely happy to answer you.
Hadvit Pharma Private Limited is a pharmaceutical company with its head office at Meerut. It was founded on 29 January 2019 with a vision to provide affordable and quality veterinary medicine to our pet parents. Hadvit Pharma is doing marketing of veterinary pharmaceuticals throughout India. In a small span of 1 year, we have launched 51 products in the veterinary pharma industry to serve our clients. In future 1 year, we are planning to have a product basket of more than 100 products. Hadvit is different from other veterinary pharma companies as we don't have distribution channel. We understand the latest needs of market, and for this reason we have adapted to online module of selling our drugs to field practitioners. We are serving our clients by providing the required medicines at their doorstep without any middleman. We directly collect orders online, mobile app, WhatsApp, telephonic from our end customers, and we deliver the required products to their doorstep through our nationwide logistic partners Blue Dart, DTDC, TCI Express. We are happy to announce that in our client list, most of the leading pet practitioners of India are included. To assure the unbreakable faith of our clients in our company products, we look after the quality of products, starting from selecting the raw material for our final products, aseptic precautions during manufacturing, and proper storage of finished products till supply to the end customers to ensure quality of products. We are happy to share that Hadvit Pharma has been recognized at various business platforms. Recently, an article on Hadvit Pharma has been published in the leading business magazine, Business Connect. One more milestone in the success story for Hadvit Pharma is that the managing director of the company, Dr. Rajneesh Tyagi, has been awarded Young Asian Entrepreneurs Award at Bangkok, Thailand on 7 February 2020. Our vision states Hadvit Pharma to be a commercially viable leading veterinary pharmaceutical company in providing quality products affordable to various sections of the pet owner society. Our endeavor is to be a front runner in innovation and quality in the veterinary pharma industry. We see a very bright future for our company as we are working in pet industry, which itself is growing at a higher rate, approximate growth of 20% annually. We are regularly working on the knowing of needs of our customers to serve them in a better way. We value your support to Hadvit Pharma and are very thankful to all of you. We look forward for a very strong and long business association between veterinarians and Hadvit Pharma. Thank you.